Welcome to Breaking Into Hollywood, the Master Course Live. This is our seventh show, I think, Gary. Could that be possible?
It's possible that it's seven.
It's gone so quickly. It's already almost the end of August. Where has the year gone? If this is your first time joining us for the Masterclass Live, welcome. If it's not, welcome again. We have a very special guest tonight, as usual, but tonight is really special because she is a hoot. I'm going to leave Gary to introduce Rima to you, but just to remind you that you can leave any questions that you have for either Gary or Rima in the comments under this live event, and I'll be watching them throughout the show, and if anything comes up, I can throw them to them. So, without further ado, let's hand over to Mr. Goldstein. Hello.
Bethan, thank you so much, and welcome to a fun session here at Breaking Into Hollywood. We've got a guest that I don't know, I have very little memory for time, but we've been friends from our experiences in the business a lot of years, I'll just say that. Rima Greer, thank you for joining us. Absolutely. And I'm gonna read this. This is an amazing bio. I'm going to read a little bit about her, and then I'll give you my two cents about Rima before we dive in. Her last name is Greer. Rima has worked as a Hollywood agent for over 25 years. She started with a desk job at the William Morris Agency. She was offered an agent position at Writers and Artists Agency in 1984. And handling both film and TV talent, she became their president of literary from 1989 to 94. Then she struck out on her own, and she started her own company called Above the Line Agency, handling writers, directors, actors, and producers. And some of her clients' films include everything from Highlander, Backdraft, Jumanjii, Constantine, Prancer, Dunston Checks In, Charlie's Angels, Imagine That, and even such proud moments, as she says, as Piranha and Child's Play. Rima has expertise in setting up projects with foreign financing and independent distribution, including films such as The Prophecy, He Was a Quiet Man, Evil Alien Conquerors, Slow Burn, Poker House, Cirque du Soleil, Alegria, and recently wrapped Skating to New York, Dryads, and Buffalo Rider. Her TV projects range from Stranger in Town to Rescue 77 to Merlin II to Category 7, and has new projects currently at NBCI and HBO. Rima has participated in a number of writers' conferences for aspiring talent, everything from the Writers Guild, UCLA, Northwestern, Willamette, Scriptwriters Showcase, and has literally traveled the globe to international film marks and festivals, as well as a lot of film locations, certainly. And in 2007, Rima began, and I love this, writing an impassioned letter to someone in the film business who was acting like, quote, a weasel. And instead of sending it, it became her first book, The Real Lowdown Dirty Truth About Hollywood Agenting, which was published by Quill Driver Books. Here it is. And Rima resides in California with Scott, her husband of 25 years. And by the way, this is a good read. This is The Lowdown Dirty Truth. And I'm just going to say, before we dive in, looking at the table of contents, there are many chapters. I'm just going to read a few that are super relevant. Who are all these people? How scripts get sold. A day in the life of an agent, getting an agent, keeping an agent, why being an agent is the best and worst job in the world. 25 truths nobody will tell you, and the unspoken rules. This is fascinating because it really gets you inside the head of what it is to be an agent representing people, and I think that's probably something we could all do well to remember or learn about as we're seeking our own representation. So, Rima, welcome.
Hi.
Hi. How's life up in northern, beautiful Northern California?
It's gorgeous here today.
Fantabulous. So, Rima, you I've known you a lot of years. You represent some of the most impeccable talent. You have managed strategic. You're one of the better strategists in the business. Because to survive, not survive, but to thrive as you have as a boutique agency throughout this sort of shift over the many years bespeaks a real sense of strategy. So I just want to start with a big canvas question about, where What is it to be an agent today? What is it to be talent today compared to what it was, say, 5, 10, 15 years ago?
Wow, that is a big question. I would say, let me start with, I miss the mid-90s when you could go out with a script and, you know, and then the studio would call you and say, what do you want for the script? And you'd say, well, what do you think I want? I want $1 million, you know, and you'd get it.
Right, the standard answer, right? $1 million.
Yeah, exactly. I know, those were fun days. Those days, unfortunately, are over. That's the bad news. But I think, for me, the good news is that back then, if you made a low-budget movie and you wanted it to be any good, you needed at least $5 million. Mm-hmm. And now, you need $500,000. I mean, you could go out and shoot a great movie on your iPhone right now if you had, you know, a great script and actors who really knew how to act and really took the time to do it. You could go out and shoot a movie on your iPhone, and it would be fantastic. So, you know, I mean, things change, and you have to change with them. And I think my friends who also do what I do in their own little companies, we actually have a little group that meets for lunch often, and we sit and we complain about stuff and trade information. And we've all had to make adjustments because the business has changed. I mean, if you're trying to do business like it was in the 90s, you're going to be in big trouble because you'd be selling pagers in an iPhone world, you know? Yeah. So I think that we've all had to get more creative about what we're doing and expand into different markets and maybe tighten our expense accounts a little bit. I mean, nobody does lunch anymore, which is actually great for me because I have a house in Northern California and I like to be up here and I don't want to be sitting in traffic in LA more than I have to, you know?
Yeah, I agree with you. I've been accused of being an optimist, and I'm okay with that. But I see that, you know, where there were many, many, many independent companies back in the day, although it did take $5 million plus to make that film, there are just as many opportunities today at far lower price points, but we do have the same amount of opportunity. It just looks different. And it does not involve people writing checks for $1 million every time you wave a script in the air. That's true.
Right. Yeah, and by the way, you also had the frustration with that. One of my $1 million sales, the movie never got made. They wrote us a check for $1 million, and it's out there, sitting there now. Probably they don't even know they own it.
No doubt. I've one or two of those of my own. But those were the days. They were, you know, they were big spending days. It was before the studios became, you know, a little bit more frugal, if you will. And are developing, their development production ratio has very changed from what it was.
Well, yeah, and there are less studios. I mean, back in the 90s, there were, God, I think when I started, there were 12 studios to sell to, and now there's, what, 3.5? 4.5. 4.5. And when was it, last week when Fox was trying to buy Warners? I'm like, really? We're going to end up with just one company. There'll be like one company called Movie.
But it'll be a hell of a back lot.
Well, yeah, exactly. But on the other hand, I mean, when I look at the projects that I'm getting done right now, very few of them are with studios. I mean, so if you look at back in the 90s, the studios were all making like 18 movies a year, and now there's fewer studios and they're doing like maybe 6. What I think is going to be interesting is to see how independent film distribution shakes out. Right now, we're kind of in that transition period where there really are no independent theatrical distributors. But theatrical doesn't really mean that much anymore. In fact, right. Theatrical can sometimes be a downside. I saw a wonderful little independent film a few months ago, and then coincidentally ended up having lunch with the producer of that film, and I was telling him how much I liked the film and asking how they got it done and you know, what would he have done differently. And he said, well, what I would have done differently is I would not have had a theatrical because it actually cost us money and it doesn't really mean anything anymore, especially for a small movie that doesn't have, you know, exploding robots or you know, big movie stars in it. So there's really no point to a theatrical. And frankly, there's a whole generation of people who don't want to go to the theater. They want to stay home in their comfortable living rooms with their, you know, zillion-inch flat screens, and they can, you know, push pause and go pee. I mean, when you're in your living room, you don't need the Run Pee app, right?
Right.
How brilliant is that, Run Pee?
It's true, but you're not guaranteed much of a run theatrically anyway, and it's no longer the day where the value of your DVD was escalated or your value of your foreign sales. If you don't have a film that's going to sell big foreign, it really becomes more or less academic.
Right, and I think it's all about the algorithms of companies like Netflix and Amazon, who look at what you bought and say, if you liked this, then you'll like that. In fact, those algorithms are so powerful now. One of my clients wrote his first novel last year. We sold it, as a real book and an ebook and all that stuff. And when we had a choice of publishers, we actually chose Amazon, or one of their imprints actually, over another more traditional kind of higher profile publisher. Because it has a very interesting niche market available to it, and we knew that Amazon would have the facility to access those people. You know, it's like, if you like this, you'll like this book. And it turns out that it was actually the number one historical fiction novel on Amazon in December, just because of that algorithm. So, I mean, if you make that great little film on your iPhone, I would not be concerned about getting it into the theaters. I would be concerned about getting it onto Netflix.
Yeah, well said. So for today's younger writer, professionally younger writer, who's interested in finding collaborators and creating content and all of that, what kind of advice do you give? I mean, do you talk about finding niche audiences or writing? You know, what kind of strategic advice do you give to a younger writer?
Well, I would say that connect with other writers. Get into a writer's group so other writers who you know, have some experience can look at your stuff and say, what about this, what about that, you should rethink this, why is your script 135 pages when it should be 111? And yeah, it's always great to have a spec. I mean, the spec sales don't happen too often anymore, but they do happen, and I have one casting right now. That was a spec out of nowhere that just somebody referred this guy to me, and it was amazing. And then he was a finalist in the Nichols Fellowship. Oh yeah, and enter all those contests, because the judges for those contests are the studio executives and the managers and the agents and the producers. And you know, somebody reads your script and they love it. I mean, it's all about finding that passion. And then I knew you were going to ask me that question. Because everyone does, and they should. So I was thinking about it this morning, and I think now with social media and the ability to make a film about anything for no money in a heartbeat and throw it up on Vimeo, I think the most important thing to do is to be an interesting person outside the film business. I once sold a TV movie to a producer who's a horse nut, because she found out that I was a level 1 certified llama hiker. Now, well, I mean, that's pretty weird, but you know, it's something that people remember about you. Yes, I hike with llamas. Okay, they're hilarious, and they carry your stuff for you.
I've got to find how did you get into llama hiking? You've got to answer that, please.
I think I was at the LA County Fair, and a llama walked up to me and stuck its nose in my ear and hummed. Because llamas hum, they go, that's what they do. And I was bitten by the llama bug. And so I ended up going out with those people hiking in the mountains, and you know, you put a pack on your llama, and they carry all your stuff for you, and they're funny, and so, you know, I don't know, can't explain it.
Love that.
And, okay, and that brings me, try it sometime. And then that brings me to finding your niche market. There is a club, a newsletter, and a YouTube channel for every possible interest in the universe. I have a client who's a writer-director, has made mainstream films for studios, and he doesn't want to work that hard right now, and so he loves shooting stuff, and so he bought himself a newfangled camera, and he and his wife went out and they shot a documentary about trains, specifically about the red cars in Los Angeles, and I think they spent $5,000 on this thing, and they have made a fortune, because if you're interested in trains, you own this DVD. It's in every train museum in the country, in their gift shop, and it sells for something like $30 for a DVD that he probably produces for $249. Okay? So, yeah, find something that interests you, and then find those other people who are interested in it, and sell your product to them. The other thing that I wanted to mention, stop me if you want to dive in here, is the idea of 1,000 true fans. This is a concept that has come out of the graphic novel community in the Pacific Northwest, I think specifically Portland. And the idea behind this is that if Marvel does not buy your graphic novel, the way to make a living as a graphic novelist is to find 1,000 true fans. And 1,000 true fans, a true fan is defined as someone who is willing to spend $100 a year on your product. Mm-hmm. And so if you have 1,000 true fans, you have $100,000, and then you're making a living, right? So I think that goes for writers and filmmakers as well. Establish your presence online. Learn how to use Google Ads. Go to Fiverr, another brilliant tool, and find someone who can clean up your search engine optimization, and create your base of 1,000 true fans. Now that means that you have to generate a lot of content, but you know that's your job.
Yeah, I say, Rima, thank you for that. I completely agree, because I'm always beating the drum that people should be creating content regardless of their art. I don't care if you're a poet. My niece is a cartoonist, and she did a Kickstarter, and she gained the first half of her first 1,000 true fans, right? She has 500 loyal backers, and she is well on her way to what I consider a sustainable career as an artist. And that's true whether you're a filmmaker or a cartoonist or whatever you might be. But I also think you're right. So it's about getting noticed in the marketplace that is your target market, and it's also about commerce and being able to keep the lights on. Right?
Right.
I mean, that was a fabulous story. And then ultimately that ties into the 1,000 true fans, so I completely agree. That's an interesting, I never would have thought about it, but yes, there's a million topics, probably close to a million topics, a la trains, right?
Oh,
it's
yeah.
Almost endless.
And those people are easily identified. They're easy to find because they belong to clubs. You know,
well, so and it ties into the earlier comment you made, which I think is really profoundly important, which is how do you stand out from the competition? How do you distinguish yourself? Well, part of it is what you write. And part of it has nothing to do with what you write. It's who are you?
Yeah.
And the who are you is the experience that you offer people, and the experience you offer is what makes you memorable. And being memorable is kind of critical. If you're going to have ongoing rapport where people are going to bring opportunity back to your front door.
Right. And that actually, this is another thing I wanted to mention. There is a TED Talk that I think the folks in this class will find very useful. The speaker's name is Simon Sinek, S-I-N-E-K. And if you go to TED and search on Simon Sinek, you'll find, I think he has two talks up there once. Now, the one that I recommend is called How Great Leaders Inspire Action. And as a companion to that, he wrote a book called Start With Why. And I think I know that after watching this TED Talk and reading his book, that which is the third book you should buy after Gary's and mine, is Start With Why. She said, shamelessly plugging. Because what he does is he breaks down the truth that people don't buy what you do, they buy why you do it. What are you really about? What are you doing this for? And I've always joked that there are movie fairies, and that if you don't make a movie for the right reasons, that the movie fairies will come and poop on your project. And I've just been borne out once again with The Expendables 3. Okay? The Expendables 3 has like every freaking movie star on the planet in it. Okay? It's a big action movie. It had lots of marketing. It should be a hit. And it's not. And I think the reason it's not is that there's no reason to make Expendables 3 except for the money. And I think the movie fairies were offended. And I think to go back to start with why is that people sense the reason why that movie exists. And they know it's not to make a great movie or to have a lot of fun or even to make them laugh or have a great time. And I think the why becomes transparent. And I think it's important on the micro level as opposed to the macro level for each artist to know why they're doing it. Why are you doing this?
Yeah, I could not agree more. We could spend a few weeks on this alone. Not only, I mean, to know why you're doing it and to communicate consistently and persistently why you care so much, because people do sense when you care. They know the difference between an authentic, you know, impassioned artist,
yeah,
or, you know, whether it's a filmmaker or any kind of artist, and someone who's doing it because there's a market for it, or they believe there's a market for it. This really gets down to something that I talk about a lot, which is, because I think an approach that a lot of writers use, because most writers do it, they follow suit, is that sort of impersonal blind query letter, where yeah, it says, dear creative executive, or dear Rima Greer, they got your name out of the directory, or mine, what have you. A very well-tailored logline or synopsis, and may I please submit my script. And it has nothing that is contagious, infectious, yeah, attractive, that either about them or, on the other hand, why they were attracted to send it to you in particular. So it becomes this rather what I consider impersonal approach. And I think that what you're describing is the flip side of that. It's like the story is interesting. What's really compelling is the person behind the, you know, the writing.
Yeah, exactly. Because actually the story probably is not that interesting because there are no new stories. I've heard every idea on the planet. I really have. So have you, Gary. I mean, you've heard every idea. There are no new ideas. There's only, I mean, anything worth making has already been made as an episode of Star Trek. So, it's true. Next time you hear a story, just like match it up with the episode. They're all there. So what you're looking for as a producer, or what you're looking for as an agent, is not the idea. You're looking for who is the person who's going to bring this to life and make it fresh and make it interesting and make us understand the message of this story in a better way, in a deeper way, a more interesting way. It's never about the idea. Yes.
How for both of you, how would one who's approaching you for the first time get that information to you that you're looking for very succinctly and very quickly at the top of their email?
Well, I have a totally different approach, so I'll dive in first and be a little bit maverick. I think the approach that's generally used is it works occasionally, but only occasionally. I think the better approach is well, to answer your question, I would write why I'm the only writer who could write the story in the way that I'm going to write it, and because this is why I care so much about this story. And, I mean, I would rewrite that 17 times. I would rewrite that query letter intro more than I rewrite my script itself. I would make it sing with such authenticity because it's so true. I would tell people exactly in two or three sentences why I'm so deeply, deeply anchored in this story. And then I would also finish by saying, you know, and I've chosen you for a reason. This is not directory driven. So I would make it, but what I would also then do, that's part two. Part one is that I wouldn't send it as an email initially. I would initiate my humanity, my contact, by picking up a telephone and calling Rima Greer's assistant or Gary Goldstein or someone's assistant. I would make it a human expected experience. because we're all wired the same. If I get an email, and I get many, and everybody gets many, yes, there's a good chance if it's really well written that I'll take a look at it, and I might even be so have my interest so piqued that I respond. But what if my assistant has now developed some kind of initial rapport over a phone because they pitched their humanity and their caring and the storyline over the phone? Now they have rapport. When that letter comes in, you can't, I'm sorry, you can't just toss it. You've actually interacted human to human. So then if you do that and you write it the way I'm suggesting, I think that's sort of the two-part formula that really I've done it all my life, so I know experientially that it gets a very different level of response.
Would you consider old-fashioned post? I'm really sorry, Rima, for jumping on for you.
No, go ahead.
If you can't get through that assistant, would you consider old-fashioned post a better way than an email, Gary?
I'm sorry, but let's back up. You said through. I don't ever want to go through an assistant to the boss. I only ever want to deal with the assistant.
Okay, so the assistant cuts you out, which I had an experience with yesterday. Just would not listen to me, did not want to push me any further.
Yeah,
but I still need to get to that person. What do I do?
Yeah. Call back on a different day and hope you have a different assistant. And if not, try a different approach. Or, you know what, move that person, that office. I mean, in the film business, look, there's a lot of people. I always do the research. I want to target those films or those TV, whatever, whether I'm in TV or film, a series of projects that bespeak, that are spiritually aligned, that are creatively aligned with what I'm offering. I want to find all the people who are associated with it. And Rima, we're going to talk in a minute about the absolute essential importance of referral in this business, the role of referral. But what I do is I think of human billiards. I play human billiards. I'm going to do a spreadsheet of the projects that impress me given my project. And I'm going to put down not just the producers and agents, which are the two categories most writers target. I'm going to put down the cinematographer. I'm going to put down the casting director. I'm going to put down the production executives. I'm going to put down whatever information I can latch on to. And I'm going to call some of those people who are not being attacked, who are not being approached persistently. And I'm going to ask their counsel, their wisdom, their advice, not ask them to read my script. I'm going to engage them in a way that makes them now a referrer, or maybe they're not going to refer me directly to someone, but I'm going to ask their opinion about a smart literary manager, about a producer, a young, hungry producer who might be right for this category of story. I'm going to make them important, make them my mentor. We've talked about this a lot. So I'm going to do a lot of elliptical things. I'm going to do a lot of sort of, you know, circuitous things to figure out where are the warm spots. If you find someone and you do, God knows, poor agents, I mean, poor assistants, they are bruised and battered and beaten and abused on a daily, hourly basis. So, yeah, they're going to be ones that you pick up the phone and, my God, the tone of voice, you just want to run the other way. And either you call back on a different day or you just move them to the bottom of your priority list.
Rima, what catches your attention?
Email, never. The minute I see what it is that it's seeking rep, delete. Immediately, delete. Snail mail, sometimes. The assistant thing, I think there's a whole section in my book called Be Nice to the Assistant, because the assistants run the world. They run the world. My assistant already decides, she decides for me who I'm going to talk to. You know, she'll come into my office or text me or whatever and say, this guy just called. He's a total jerk. He wants this from you. What do you want to do? And if he's been a jerk to my assistant, I'm not even going to call him back. But if she says, oh, I talked to this person and they were so nice and it was really interesting because she's doing this and that, you know, then, yeah, then I'll call them back. I would say the most important thing is the referral, as Gary just said. It's all about the referral. It's all somebody I know knows this person or read something or just met them at a party and thought they were interesting. If one of my friends calls me up and says, hey, I met this person, they want to talk to you for 10 minutes, I will absolutely do it. But the the sort of dry query thing, never. And a lot of what Gary was talking about is, you know, kind of dovetailed with what I said about make yourself an interesting person. You know, why are you the best person in the world to write this story? And because I love it is not the answer. The answer is because, okay, there was a young writer who walked into my office in 1984. God, I'm old. And I had read a script of his because somebody had referred it to me, and I met with him to find out what else he was thinking, and I said, what do you want to write next? And he said, well, I kind of want to write this movie about firemen. And I'm like, why firemen? He said, well, I was a fireman, and I went into people's houses, and, you know, that was really interesting, and that movie, Ron Howard directed that movie, you know? So it worked out well. But it was because he was interesting. He had the experience that made that idea come alive. And then I also want to talk about Gary's spreadsheet, his database of people who are the right people for him to talk to. That's so important. Know your stuff. See every movie. Figure out who worked on it. And play 6 degrees of separation. I mean, when I get a script on my desk that I think is worth selling, the first thing I'll do is talk to my client, writer or director, about, you know, who should be part of this movie. And then we'll start playing 6 degrees of separation of those people. Like, you know, you don't call Russell Crowe's agent to get Russell Crowe. It doesn't work that way. What you do is you call the manager for his best friend actor who was also in that movie. Or you call one of the producers on that movie, you know, who hopefully you already know, but if you don't, you make friends with their assistant, right? And also, make friends with other people who are in your sort of cohort in the business. You're a newbie, they're a newbie. Make friends with all the newbies, because one of you is going to break in. And, I mean, when I was first answering phones at William Morris, oh yeah, get a job answering phones too, that's a really good way. When I was first answering phones at William Morris, my boss was covering the studio where Jerry Bruckheimer was at the time, I think it was Paramount. And there was this young guy working for Jerry Bruckheimer, and his name was Casey. And so every day I'd pick up the phone and go, hey Casey, it's Rima, is Jerry there for Deborah? And Casey and I would chat. And you know, Casey ended up being president of production for Universal. And I did really well at Universal when Casey was there, because he and I were already friends, because we had been answering the phones to each other. So don't ignore your own cohort.
Yeah, people matriculate so quickly in unexpected directions in this business that everybody needs to be your friend.
Yeah, and not just because you want their help. Like, actually be their friend.
Yeah.
Find out what you have in common. I've sold 4 movies to a producer friend of mine because we got to be friends right away because we're both ex-ballet dancers. You know, it's like we bonded over the ballet thing.
Now she runs a whole interest group for people who love ballet and hike with llamas.
Yeah, right. Ballet with llamas.
Yeah. But I mean, if people want to deal with you on a human level. They don't just want to be, you know, they don't want to pick up more, you know, more friends who just want you because what can you do for me?
Yeah. Anyone can express their self-interest. Anyone can regurgitate what's in the trades that week or that day. What makes the journey a lot more interesting and a lot more productive and a lot more fun, personally, is when you develop some real friendships. And everybody, you know, it's an interesting culture, and this goes across the whole of the landscape. I think it's you know, it doesn't matter whether you're studio or indie. I don't care if it's network, TV or film. I think it's the same thing. Everybody is interested in forging relationships with quality folks because we all know that down the road, it's going to be better and more interesting and more, we're stronger together, we're better together, right?
Right.
Maybe it's not because they can help me. Maybe it's just because I really need a trusted voice, a sounding board. Maybe I just need a friend to talk to. It could be as simple as that. But I think that in being willing to invest yourself express yourself, let yourself be known, and start creating friendships with entry-level people is one of the great great investments you can make in the future of your career.
Yeah, and you might actually end up with some great friends. But one of my best friends in the business is another agent who does exactly what I do, and you would think that we would be competitors, but we share the same lawyer, and he introduced us, and we actually help each other, and it's great to have that kind of support system. And then we've actually done projects together where, you know, like my writer, her producer, or that kind of thing. It's fun.
So, Rima, in when we talk about referral, I just want to go one step further in that, because I think it's something that people, it's something that's really available to people if they really understood the how to do it and the relevance of it. So, for example, you represent X number of clients across these different disciplines. And, like, what percentage of clients that you've signed in the last number of years have come through, are sort of been introduced to you by way of existing clients or existing, how many people did you meet on your own versus got introduced to you by people that are already in your inner circle?
100% referral. 100%.
Okay.
Wow.
Yeah, that pretty much sums it up. Rima's not exceptional. That's just the way we're wired, and that's the way the business works. People and we're all open to it. Everybody's open to it because this business lives on a steady diet of expectation, discovery, and finding that next great talent, whatever it is. Could be a young producer, could be a writer, could be an actor, could be anything. Who knows? But I think that it's really important that people understand the more relationships you have, the more likely someone's going to open another unexpected door. And again, you do
absolutely.
It
for the right...
Go ahead.
And you don't know where that person's going to come from either.
Never.
Yeah, I mean, you can make out a plan. I'm going to talk to this person, we'll talk to that person, we'll talk to that person. It never will work out that way. In fact, one of my million-dollar sales back in the 90s happened because I gave it to the guy who was going to give it to the guy at the studio, and that studio said no, but he was reading it in bed, and his wife liked it, and so then she took it to her guy, and then he took it to his studio, and so the studio that I never even sent it to is the one who bought it.
You just made me think of... So this woman comes to me, this is years ago, and I won't name names, but this woman comes to me years ago with actually a great story, a great project, and I said, oh, you know, I know exactly who that's right for. You need to take that to so-and-so,
uh-huh.
who runs a very big independent company at the time, was making just scads of films, good films. And she said, I know, I can't. I said, why would you throw dirt on such a magnificent, I'm willing to introduce you. She said, we're in the process of divorcing.
That's hilarious.
Of all the gin joints, right?
Yeah, and it goes the other way too. A producer friend of mine called me up when I was out with a spec, and he calls me and he says, oh my God, you have to give me that spec because the guy I'm working for, if I don't get it, he's going to kill me. And I'm like, you're never buying this movie. It was this little romantic comedy, and these people did big action movies. I'm like, Kurt, you're never buying this script. Don't even waste your time reading it. Really, you're never buying it. He's like, no, I have to get it in. At least just please just send it to me. Humor me. I'm like, I'll bet you $100 you will never buy this script. I had to pay him. They bought it. You never would have thought.
Yeah.
In a million years. I mean, they were making giant, stupid action movies, and they bought this little romantic comedy.
Yeah,
go figure.
But it is to be figured because we're all human beings. You know what? You can't second guess. You should have no judgment ever about who you're going to end up being friends with, about who's going to be interested in your work, about any of this. But if you write stuff that moves people, now you start to place a bet that on average, some people that otherwise wouldn't may be attracted to your work because you gave them an experience that was important. That's why
exactly.
They're
interested. But I think to go with that, I also want to stress, do your homework. If you don't understand how to structure a script for a movie, no matter how interesting you are or how great your idea is or how well you told the story, well, It is about how well you told the story. You need to know the basics. You need to understand structure. My favorite example is John Lennon's Rolls Royce. If you're going, do you remember John Lennon's Rolls Royce?
Yes, I do.
Yeah, it was painted crazy, paisley, psychedelic, but he didn't create some car with six wheels and nine headlights and upside down and then paint it paisley. He took a Rolls Royce and then painted it paisley. So you want your underpinnings to be like classic and defined and what people understand as a movie, and then paint it all the pretty colors you want.
What a brilliant analogy. I love that.
Never John Lennon's Rolls Royce. Google it. It was awesome.
All right. I will check that out this evening. So, Bethany, do we have questions for Rima before, I can't believe we're already, 40 minutes into the hour.
That's absolutely crazy. Yes. Let me go back and find it. I'm really sorry. Do you ever help package a project, Rima, is a question that we've had from Natalie.
Yes. The way the film business works right now, if you don't package a project, you're never getting it done. You have to put everything together. Packaging is fraught with difficulties because you have to know who wants who and how badly. It's tough when you start attaching people to your project that sometimes will cause financiers or distributors to say no. And who people say yes and no to can change on a daily basis. So you really need some experienced guidance in that. It's like, don't go out and try and put that together yourself unless you're planning on financing your movie, in some crazy independent way. If you're talking about packaging to make a studio movie or something approaching a studio-sized movie, you really got to know who's who and how to get that done. And that also becomes difficult because on the representation side of that, let's say I have this fantastic script that's absolutely perfect for Helen Mirren, okay? I can call up Helen Mirren's manager and agent and say, I have the perfect thing for Helen and she's going to love it, but if I don't have all my money together and my distribution together, they're probably never going to show it to her because what if she loves it and then we can't get it done? Then they look like idiots. So everybody's kind of running around covering their butt, and that tends to be counterproductive, although everyone has to do it because you've got to cover your butt, right? So packaging is complicated.
It's complicated, but it is also, there's an intentionality behind what you're describing that is really, really essential. Like, there's a way to go conspiratorially to the representatives in your example of Helen Mirren and say, look, I'm not making you a cash offer right now. My distribution, I'm in talks with people, but it's not locked in. I want to know if you would support this. If you've developed a rapport, they'll probably read it, and they'll probably give you an honest response. Sometimes you need to help someone who's in the marketplace on a very active week-in, week-out basis, like a Rima, an agent, or it might be a producer's rep, it could be a sales agent, it could be a lot of different kinds of people. You also, in the same way that you need a good line producer so you have a proper budget, you really do know what you're talking about economically. It's not a range of $5 to $50 million for the film, which we hear a lot. And so that when you're talking with the reps of different people, filmmakers, actors, others, you actually can say, I know approximately what we're going to be talking about. The good news is that there's probably more availability today. I mean, back in the day that Rima was talking about when we were selling scripts for $1 million, people there were so many more films being made. There was just a lot of activity, and talent was getting booked. I remember going to, depressing though it may be for Joe Pantoliano, I heard him at one summit, the Future of Film Summit, say that his price, he works just as much today as he's ever worked, which is like unbelievable. The guy works nonstop. But his price got cut 85%, so he was getting 15 cents on the dollar. And his agent, he had a big agent. It's not like his agent could do anything about it. That was the law of supply and demand. The good news for the writers and the producers and the creatives of the world is that there's a lot more talent available to us today, but we still have to sort of respect the rules of the road and engage people in the proper way, which is what Rima's really addressing.
Yeah, so, I think that's really true. So if you can get to, you know, if you can get to Matt Damon's hairdresser, yeah, you might do your little indie, maybe, if he likes it.
Matt Damon, it's funny you say that, because Matt Damon just fought tooth and nail to try and get friends of mine to hold off doing a $2 million film, because he fell in love with it.
Awesome.
But he had two massive projects back-to-back, and it was going to be out of the question, so he's not doing it, and they can't wait that long.
But I mean,
I know the casting director, I know the producer, and both of them told me the same story, and I believe it to be true, because I know the project. But it's interesting that you get, you know, there are actors who won't. They won't get excited unless there's a big payday. But I would say a majority of them are really interested in a role that they can sink their teeth into. And if you can offer them that, you've got a leg up.
Right. And you can also go the road of going to actors' managers who are often also producers and say, you know what, I can't make you a cash offer right now, but will you produce this with me because it's perfect for your guy? Mm-hmm. And sometimes that works.
There's another question here that goes back to the llamas, Rima, but I think this is a really important point for people. Alethea is asking, could you please elaborate on creating a presence online? You mentioned posting content and making yourself interesting. I think that was in relation to somebody really standing out for you. I think it's putting personality behind a name rather than just a script. Is that the way to look at it?
Exactly. I mean, you can shoot video, put it up on YouTube, put it up on Vimeo, make your Facebook page really interesting. You know, I mean, everybody's on Facebook, right? There's tons of stuff you can do. I mean, when, you know, if someone refers someone to me, I'm going to Google them. And I'm going to find out, you know, what has this person been doing? Do they have stuff out there? What are they saying about stuff? I mean, make sure you know what's out there on the web about you.
Okay. I think Carrie just walked away. Maybe he's trying to find a llama class.
I was searching llama. I just realized that I needed a power cord, and now I feel more powerful. Thank you.
Okay. I have another question for Rima. Great, they're coming in. Thank you so much. Cynthia, Anne is asking, how many scripts on average, Rima, do most of your writers have before you took them on to represent them?
Good question.
Sometimes it's one. Usually it's less scripts than more scripts. Because someone who's written 25 scripts and still hasn't found an agent, it's probably because the scripts aren't that great. So even if you have written 25 scripts, don't say so.
Good point.
And don't list them in a bucket list on your query letters.
Yeah.
Please. That makes everything unspecial.
Yeah, I mean, don't forget that in order to get a movie made, a whole bunch of people have to think that your project is worth spending a year of your life and millions of dollars on. I mean, a lot of people. Your agent, the director, the director's agent, the director's manager, the director's wife, the producer's agent, the producer's wife or husband, the studio executive and their assistant and then their boss and their assistant and the chairperson of the studio and the movie star and the movie star's astrologist and yoga teacher. I mean, all these people have to agree all at the same time. And so in order to make that happen, you have to create something that people can really feel passionate about. I mean, it's kind of a tall order, but it does happen on a regular basis, so it must be possible. And I mean, I know the projects that I'm working on. I've got a movie that's It's been casting. This is the fourth time it's been casting. It's the third time I've had it financed, and I'm going to get this movie made if it's the last thing I do. If I croak before this movie gets made, I'm going to be pushing the lid of my coffin up, going, but wait, you know. And that's the kind of thing that you need to inspire in people in order to get an agent or get a manager or get a producer interested or get a movie star to say yes. You know, I mean, it takes a lot.
It takes a village. And it also takes a lot of rejection, so you have to feel that way.
Oh, pff. If I had a nickel for every time I heard no, I'd be a zillionaire. I'd be doing this for my yacht. No is the second best answer.
Yep.
The worst answer is maybe.
Yes. Frustrating. We have so many questions coming in for you. Lynn's saying, I read an interview you gave to moviebytes.com. You mentioned that you enjoy helping writers become directors. How do you do that?
Well, it used to be, when scripts were worth a lot of money, that you would say, we'll take half if you let the writer direct. And if they loved it enough, that could happen. That used to work. Doesn't really work now. Now, what you do is you go on Indiegogo or Kickstarter, and you buy 4 iPhones and tripods, and you shoot a movie. And what I do is I help put you together with people who can make sure that the result you end up with is good. Like, when there's one producer in particular who actually ended up being my client because I'm the only agent he'll talk to. Whenever I have a first-time director, I try to get him to produce it because I know that even if my director is an idiot or drunk or dead, that the film will come out good.
Okay, thank you very much. Gary, over to you.
Yeah, no, and I would say that's true across the board. It's the editor. I mean, you need someone who understands how to compose a frame. You need someone who knows how to edit a film. You need someone who can make your actors look good. So it's all that support above, you know, that below the line support. They're critical. That said, you know, there's nothing wrong with shooting your first film with cell phones.
Oh yeah, do it.
In fact, an Oscar was what was it? Sugar Man? I forget the name of it. Wonderful story about a guy in Detroit that won an Oscar, a singer who was unknown in Detroit or in his own country, but was like the Elvis Presley of South Africa. And it was a fascinating story. The filmmaker started shooting on Super 8. Ran out of funding, and discovered that there was an app on his smartphone called Super 8, finished shooting the film on the app on his phone, and got nominated and won the Oscar for Best Documentary.
That is the best story ever.
It's amazing, right? So today, I mean, you know, there are the cineasts who care and talk about this camera, that camera, this shooting on film versus video. Look, just tell a brilliant story with great characters. That's it. That's what makes a great storyteller. And I agree. I'd rather see people shooting on smartphones than waiting for their big break on a studio film.
And I guess that also shows that you've got the proactiveness to go out there and showing you really want it, that you just haven't put something on paper, that you've actually put it on your phone. Yet that takes some coordination, some thinking, some planning. That's showing that you're really, really hungry.
Oh, yeah. No agent wants to represent someone who's just going to say, where's my job? That's the first way to get fired by your agent.
Yeah.
my answer to that is, where's my new script?
The happiest complaint from a creative person I've ever heard is, my agent has never gotten me a job. I get all my jobs. Well, of course you get all your jobs. That's your job. You're your personality. Of course it's up to you to go into the room and be beloved, tell a compelling, persuasive story, and get the job.
Yeah, what your agent does is help connect you with people and give you credibility and make sure that you don't get screwed as badly as you would have without their protection.
That, I think that's a really important point. If we could actually rewind that a little bit, Rima, and if you could talk about what you see as your responsibility as an agent from the very beginning for people just entering the business.
Well, at the end of it all, my responsibility is to make my client happy. What that means is connect them with the other people in the business who I know, who I think will treat them well and who will be a good match for them, to help them decide what direction to go creatively based on what's going on in the marketplace and what I think their strong suit is, and to, above all, to protect them, both creatively and in the deal, to make sure that you know, the producer who asks them to do 5 free drafts only gets one, you know, half a free draft, to make sure that they get paid on time, to make sure that their contracts are in shape, to make sure that they're making good choices. You know, if you have a choice of who to go with, who do you choose? You know, it's my job to know all those people and know what the good choices are.
Thank you. Gary?
Yeah, I mean, I think underneath all of that, Rima's job, or any good representative, manager, agent, doesn't matter, I think it's all the same, is really to care enough to educate them every step of the way, whether it's about choosing wisely their relationships, having a strategy about what first and what to aim for later, how not to overstep bounds so you can get yeses. I mean, there's so much education and nuance in this process. It's not necessarily always an obvious business, so it takes some learning curve.
And a lot of this is cumulative. It's cumulative. Like what the work that your agent does today. Oh, holy cow! I just had this happen. I made a deal for one of my clients almost 11 years ago, and project sat there forever and ever, and stuff went, you know, stuff disappeared, and just stuff happened. And out of the blue, this project got picked up by a major studio, and because of the deal I made 11 years ago, he got a check for $175,000 last week.
Whoa, after 11 years?
Yes.
Nice.
So it's, what have I done for him lately? Well, that deal 11 years ago.
Fantastic. Okay, there's a really interesting question that come here. Do either of you, Gary or Rima, feel that exceptional comedy writers find opportunities more easily than well-versed drama writers? Is there a bigger market for comedy than drama? Do either of you have a thought on that?
What time is it? That's the answer. What time is it? What's in style today? What was this week's big hit?
What came out last week that everyone's talking about?
Exactly. And you can't write to the marketplace. You can't write to the marketplace because by the time you spent 90 days writing your next script and really it's going to be brilliant after your first pass in 90 days, I don't know. The fad that you're writing for is gone. It's passed. You have to do it from the inside.
Yeah.
What do you care about?
Gary, our hour is up.
Yeah, I mean, I think that we need to, it's a great question because it really points up just how important it is to love what you're writing and working on, to care so deeply about it. The only thing you can do is write you.
Yeah.
You know? And if you're thinking about those kinds of, I'll call them intellectual constructs, trying to, and it's legitimate. I understand the motivation is very real, very poignant and very, very honest, because this is a learning process. But take to heart Rima's answer, because there really is no good answer to that other than write the very best story you're capable of writing, regardless of whether it's comedic or dramatic.
Absolutely. Well, and I wanted to add one other thing that you can do to sort of round out your education in moving through the business. Go take acting class, because you will learn what lines sound like coming out of actors' mouths. You'll learn how actors think, and you might meet some actors.
Mm-hmm. Good point. Great.
Amen. So I'm looking at that. We're at the hour, for God's sakes. Is there any one last question that must be answered, Bethan, on your side?
No, I think we're good. It would be great if we could get Rima to take a look at a few of the questions afterwards and maybe offer some answers on the Google page.
I'm happy to do that.
Yeah, that'd be great. Thank you.
Rima, you're the best. Thank you. And again, you know, for those of you who really want to understand a little bit more deeply the mindset of the representative, in this case the agent, Rima's book is actually really quite revealing. It's written sort of very gut level. It's not a lot of theory. So, Rima, you're fabulous. Thank you so much. I really appreciate you being part of our show and coming on this Hangout, joining Bethan and myself and our motley crew.
Thanks, Gary. This was really fun.
Well, wonderful. So, Bethan, any announcements, or is Breaking into Hollywood good to go for the evening?
I think we're good to go for the evening. We did send out an email last night, a mass email. If you didn't get it, please make a note here. We discovered that we had a big, giant hole in the Breaking into Hollywood.
Well, I think we lost you. I don't know. Or was that me?
I'm still here, but I think we lost Bethan.
Okay. So what Bethan was saying, I'll just pick that up. We did discover there was a gaping hole in the universe. Sad though that is. And that was the back end, the technical side, the back end of our website. Up until just these last few several days, we repaired it. The website is refreshed, it's renewed, it's much more robust. So we had a lot of people who were trafficking the site and actually attempting to transact on the site, meaning buy the master course, Breaking into Hollywood, the master course. So quite a number of people attempted it, apparently, we saw, and were frustrated. And we apologize for that. And we sent out an email. Bethan sent out an email, I believe, just today. So look in your inboxes, because we're offering, I think it was a significant $75 discount. And we don't know who all those people were. It's IP numbers. We're not allowed to know that. So for everyone, for the time being, we're just going to say thank you, and we appreciate your forgiving us for that inconvenience. So there's a discount if you wanted to sign up for the master course. And I think Bethan's gone, yes? All right, fabulous. Once again, Rima, thank you. And both of us will dive in and go look at the comments. And I just really appreciate it, honestly. Thank you so much.
My pleasure. Anytime.
All right,
thanks,
beautiful. Have a lovely evening.
You too.
All righty.
Bye.
Night. Breaking into Hollywood. All right, I think.
Okay, I got it.